Very good evening, friends. If at all I am visible and audible. So if at all I am visible and audible, please do give me a thumbs up. So good evening, friends. Yeah, okay, thank you for confirming, Monster. Okay, so I hope all of you enjoyed the previous session of gynecology by Dr. Ramesh Sriman. So in this session, we are going to see what were all the dermatology questions. Yes, thank you for all the confirmation, Naveen, Moksh. Okay, I want to tell a few points about this particular exam, FMG exam. So I would like to first tell you that this particular session was thoda hatke in the case of dermatology is what I understood from talking to various students, because unlike every year in FMG, in this particular exam there were so many dermatology related questions which I have compiled here. If in case you have written the exam and if you feel that these questions were somewhat different or options are somewhat different, or any additional questions are there, or any question which I have discussed is not there, please you can always message me personally. I will look into the whatever you have mentioned, and I will make the necessary changes. And this particular session, if you want as a soft copy, then you just message me personally, or most probably in my group I am going to put it, so you can always download it and revise. And if case any new questions are there, any question which is kept here is did not came in the exam, you please do let me know. Okay, this is Dr. Madhuren Srinivas. I am your dermatology educator on Unacademy platform. If you are not yet following me on Unacademy, you can follow me for all the latest videos. And just briefly, this is Iconic subscription. Maybe you are all aware that along with Unacademy, you can take the PrepLadder subscription also. Both of them put together, it is available for these costs. And this is my code, DRMSD. You can use this to avail the 10% off. Okay, so let's begin the show. So please tell me whether this question came in the exam and what have you answered it. So I heard that many students told that this particular question came. Yes, Sadaf says C. Okay. So this question came, right? Were the options same? What was the option D, if at all you remember? Okay, thank you. So this question came. So this is actually a straightforward question, to be frank. So auspid sign, it is seen in the case of psoriasis vulgaris. So very good, most of you have answered it right. But please remember, there is only one point which I wanted to tell, that auspid sign, there is one small article in which you can see all the most important points about the auspid sign. See, basically what is done here, papillosquamous disorders, among which this auspid sign is seen, is not only psoriasis but also actinic keratosis, and also we can see in vesiculobullous disorder, Darius disease. So this might be a next level question, if in case AIIMS or AIIMS people do ask. So this is the one thing which I wanted to tell you. And apart from that, if we try to scrape the lesion, the scales will be removed, and initially there will be a lot of scales which will be removed. That's why called as candle wax sign, and followed by which there will be appearance of Bartley's membrane. And if you remove the Bartley's membrane also with this slide, if you try to scrape continuously, then we will get pinpoint bleeding, and this pinpoint bleeding is called as a auspid sign. Okay, so this is seen in psoriasis because of there are elongated dermal vessels, and that is histopathological correlation with the clinical demonstration of the auspid sign. So histopathologically there are elongated dermal vessels and suprapapillary thinning of the epidermis. That is the reason why we are able to see this pinpoint bleeding. So this is a bit easy question. And one more thing which I want to tell all of you is that despite the name be having psoriasis, inverse psoriasis, pustular type of psoriasis and guttate psoriasis, and even erythrodermic variant of psoriasis, these are all types of psoriasis. In these, please remember auspid sign is negative. Okay, so in the question, even pustular psoriasis was there, was what students told. Please tell me whether pustular psoriasis was mentioned in the question or not, in the options. Okay. Okay, fine, fine. So yes, no doubt. See, whatever questions we are framing, definitely there might not be exactly the exam questions. Why? Because many students told me that the questions were extremely lengthy and so much of time was wasted just for reading the question. Because of that, they were not having time. So I agree with what few students are telling, that it was not so much straightforward. So yes, the question might have been a little lengthy. I agree with you. So please tell me if this, so many students told me this question was there. So please answer this question. So Maulik is telling fourth option was lupus. Okay, I have noted it down. So lupus, so please remember, but lupus will not show auspid sign. Okay, okay. Bindu Madhavi is telling topical retinoids. Okay, even picture was given. So was picture given or the question mentioned that the first line treatment of acne comedons? What was the exact question? Can anyone type in? Was only comedone picture was given or was it mentioned in the question also? So yes, most of you have pic was given. Acha, okay, okay, fine, fine. So I got students telling that acne comedones was given. Fine. So I will just tell you first what is the answer. So answer here is yes, as most of you answered, it is topical retinoids. And I will also show you the image. Maybe it was like this, open comedones or closed comedones. That is blackheads and whiteheads in layman language. So this acne vulgaris treatment, acha, okay. Medico Magic says it was mentioned in question also. Thank you, Medico Magic. Thank you for that. Okay. So the acne vulgaris is divided into four grades, and depending upon the grade, we are going to treat the patient. So if it is comedones, please remember it is going to be topical retinoids. And among the retinoids also, please remember adapalene is the preferred agent over tretinoin. And one more point which can be asked in the next December session FMG or also any of the NBE based questions is that isotretinoin may also be in the options. Please remember isotretinoin is not available in topical formulations. Isotretinoin is used for grade 4 or most severe form of acne vulgaris. It is a oral systemic agent, and if it is grade 2, that is predominantly papular erythematous papular lesions are there, then along with topical retinoids we will also prescribe topical. So sorry guys, there was a power cut, so please if at all, so I hope I'm back again. So sorry for that interruption friends, there was a power cut at my place. Okay, so let us continue. So in grade 3, there will be predominantly pustules and the treatment is going to be, so I hope I am back again. My audio and video are back, I think. Okay, please confirm once, friends, Maulik and Veena. Sorry for the interruption, there was a power cut. Okay, so yes, in grade 3 there will be pustules predominantly, and in this topical retinoids will be given, and benzoyl peroxide can also be added. Along with that, oral antibiotics are the ones which are going to be prescribed. Okay, thank you, thank you, thank you for confirmation. And in oral antibiotics, it is tetracyclines which are preferred, and it is doxycycline which is preferred over minocycline. And in grade 4, it is going to be nodulocystic type of acne. Nodulocystic type of acne, and isotretinoin is going to be the treatment of choice here. So yes, now please tell me if this question was given in the exam. Were the options same, and was there any difference in the question or image? Please do let me know in the options here. Exact. Okay, picture is different. Okay, so options were same. So what have you answered it as? So what do you feel, guys? What is the answer you feel? Okay, thank you for confirmation. Same. Okay, picture was different. Okay, please do message me the picture, whatever was asked. Okay, so what have you answered? Yes, so acha 20 years history. Okay. Okay, yes, very good. The answer here is malignant melanoma. But briefly, I just want to tell you about the other option. Was nevus pilus in the options? I got to know from few students that nevus pilus was in the options. Yes, very good. All of you are right. Malignant melanoma. Was nevus pilus in the options, or it was not there? Okay, Fernandez noted. History of 20 years was given. I will add it in the in my this thing, the question. Okay, nevus pilus was not there. Okay, fine. So I just want to show you how basal cell carcinoma and squamous cell carcinoma will appear. So the basal cell carcinoma, it is going to appear in this fashion. So it is going to be a translucent nodule with surface showing telangiectasias. And also there can be formation of the ulcer, which will have this characteristic rolled out edges. Okay. Okay. Thank you so much. Okay. Bleeding was there. Okay, Shanti. Thank you. Thank you for that. So if at all basal cell carcinoma will be asked, so that is going to be given like this. Either it should be given as a properly translucent nodule with surface showing telangiectasias. These are the telangiectasias which you can see here. That is dilated capillaries. And other than that, they can also give you a rolled out edged ulcer, or otherwise a pigmented type of ulcer. Ulcer also can be given. And if it is case of squamous cell carcinoma, either in the question they will mention indurated everted edges. So these will be mentioned. Okay. And briefly, I will tell about malignant melanoma and how we have come to the diagnosis of malignant melanoma in this case. So please remember, it is ABCD. I hope in surgery also you might have read this ABCD, all of which are present in this particular. Okay, in this picture, we can see all the characteristics. That is, there is a asymmetry of the lesion. There is asymmetry of the lesion, and also there is. You can see that at places there is hyperpigmentation, which is more pronounced than the other areas. And also you can see there are other features as well. All of which are there is a color difference, which I have already told, and the diameter, of course, it is obviously larger than 6 millimeters, which is almost covering the entire cheek. And evolution they have not mentioned, but if at all, at least three four of these are there, then we can diagnose, and we should always keep malignant melanoma as one of the options. Okay, and yes. So these are all the things. And please remember, the best indicator for prognosis or prognostication of malignant melanoma is the depth. And that Breslow's classification is the one which is used, which will tell us about the history about, that means it, we can do a histopath and get to know what is the depth until which melanoma is involved, and depending upon that our treatment will be like, if at all there is 1 millimeter of infiltration as depth wise, then we have to remove 1 centimeter of the adjacent normal looking skin. So this is the thumb rule which you must follow. 1 mm or 5.5 millimeters invasion, we are going to remove 0.5 centimeters of the normal looking adjacent skin. So it is like that, 1 millimeter is equal to 1 centimeter is the thumb rule. Okay, so now please see this question and tell me if this question was asked. Yes, okay, yes sir, there was bleeding of that lesion. Yes Dr. Tuba, even if bleeding was mentioned, then also the answer is going to be malignant melanoma only. Why? Because it is having pigmentation. Okay, so please tell me if this question and this image was given in the exam. Okay, Fernandez is telling question of ulcer on the neck. Okay, please at the last once tell me about this question, that question called ulcer or the neck. Okay Fernandez, I will remember at the last 10 minutes. We'll see. Okay, yes it came. Okay, so so please what have you answered it, what did you feel? So okay, okay, I can see few S's and okay. Okay, so Aniket is telling question about impetigo with image. So so this is a classical image of impetigo, that is non-bullous type of impetigo, Dr. Aniket. Non-bullous type of impetigo. So if this came there and the question was this common complication associated with the following condition, then the answer is going to be post-streptococcal glomerular nephritis. Please remember there are two types of impetigo, which of which non-bullous type is the most common one. It is also called impetigo contagiosum. Okay, so in this the causative agent most commonly is seen is streptococcus, and also one more thing is the picture is showing this characteristic honey colored crust, also called as golden yellow colored crusting. So if this is there, then you should always diagnose it as non-bullous type of impetigo. And please remember the most important complication associated with non-bullous type of impetigo is post-streptococcal glomerular nephritis, and that is because of streptococcal M49 strain which is going to infect the skin. So this is the point which is very important. And in the case of bullous type of impetigo, so there can be a possibility of staphylococcal. Just tell me if in the option staphylococcal scarlet skin syndrome, that is SSSS, was given in the options or it was not given. Okay, Shanti Umapati says case of impetigo with flu like beta hemolysis. Okay, thank you Shanti for the input. Okay, point noted. So so not the image, they have mentioned that case of impetigo with beta hemolysis. Okay, point noted. So in that case also it is going to be non-bullous impetigo which is going to have a causative agent as streptococcus. Why? Because bullous impetigo is only and only caused by staphylococcus aureus. Please remember this very important point. So it is not going to be bullous impetigo, that is it is not going to have a complication, that is staphylococcal scarlet skin syndrome. Okay, so I hope everyone understood it. If what Shanti Umapatti has told is correct, then it is actually very easy in a way. Why? Because it is not a case of bullous impetigo, as beta hemolysis has been mentioned in the question. So do everyone of you agree with what Dr. Shanti Umapatti says? So please reply yes or no. If the question mentioned beta hemolysis, please do type in the chat section with yes. They asked for honey colored crusting found in impetigo caused by. Okay, Dr. Revati Patnaik says they asked for honey-colored crusting found in impetigo frostbite. Okay, so then I think maybe that is an another question. I feel like questions are too much history and symptoms that it made us more confused. Yes, Dr. Tuba, I totally agree with what you are saying. Yes, many students have told me that the questions are so lengthy. I agree with you 100%. So yes, this session was somewhat different. Mention of SSSS is the correct one. Okay, thank you Hanif for the inputs. Okay, now we'll move on to the next question. So was this question there and were these the options or any other different options were given? So please type in your answer in the chat section, friends, that this question was given and were the options same or different. Okay, Shamshir is telling Streptococcus. Okay, fine, same. Thank you for confirmation. So this is also an important question, and what I have observed is that from infections they were asking so many questions. Some student also told that some ulcer or the neck was given. So if I am correct, maybe that was something related to tuberculosis. Maybe it was scrofuloderma. I don't know what the question is, but one thing what is my observation in this paper is from dermatology they have asked like so many of the infectious conditions. So infections are damn important, as you can see in the coming questions. They are also chicken pox, hand foot mouth disease. So infections are very 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 important is the carry home message which I understood. Okay, bacteroids was there in the option. Okay, thank you Abhishek Pandey. Okay, thank you Fernandez. Okay, but here the answer is going to be it is yes, Streptococcus. Most of your answer picture was given of a man. Okay, even picture was given. Okay, Savita, yeah, point noted. So here the answer is Streptococcus, and there are very very important picture was given. Okay, so there are some important difference to be read while reading erysipelas and cellulitis. You always read them side by side so that it will be very very easy while you are trying to revise. So because it revision is very important at the end, so please remember erysipelas, it is also called as Saint Antonius fire. And please remember erysipelas, the causative agent is going to be only and only group A beta hemolytic streptococcus. Okay, but in the case of cellulitis, both staph and strep can be the causative agents, and even the depth of involvement is also different. In erysipelas, it is very superficial, upper half of the dermis, that is papillary dermis and part of the reticular dermis will be involved along with lymphatics, whereas in cellulitis, lower half of dermis, that is mainly reticular and also subcutis, that is panoculus or hypodermis also can be involved. And because it is very superficial, the margins are going to be raised and they are going to be well defined, whereas in cellulitis it is going to be very ill defined because it is very deep. Okay, image was given. Okay, the point is noted, friends. So image was also given. Okay, so please tell me whether this particular question was given or it was not given, and was this image given, was the question body same and or the options same, and what have you answered for this question? So please type in your answer also. Okay, yes, so what answer have you marked, friends? Okay, very good, Sharad Paul. Squamous cell carcinoma. Okay, Veena says actinic keratosis. Okay, so please remember those who have answered, in case actinic keratosis, please remember actinic keratosis itself is a premalignant lesion. The question is precisely asking the cutaneous horn can advance into what skin cancer. That is, question is asking what skin cancer. Okay, so Shilpa is telling why not basal cell carcinoma. Okay, please remember it is an observation which was noted in all the patients of cutaneous horn, and it was observed that almost half of the patients who had this cutaneous horn, the cutaneous horn, it is basically hard keratin substance which is protruding out of the skin as a conical projection. Okay, it is a compact keratin, and what was observed, it is same like animal horn on consistency. That is, if you touch this cutaneous horn with your hand, it will be same it is same very hard like if you touch an animal horn. And it was noted that almost half of the horns, half of these cutaneous horn, have benign base, and half of them are either premalignant or malignant. Please remember, the benign conditions which can be seen at the base are seborrheic keratosis, viral warts. And please remember, the premalignant condition which can be seen is actinic keratosis, and the malignant change which can be seen is squamous cell carcinoma. So it is observed that squamous cell carcinoma is the one which is associated with cutaneous horn, but not basal cell carcinoma. Okay, so how can you, so this can be the next level of the question, how can you say that the horn is likely to be due to squamous cell carcinoma, underlying squamous cell carcinoma, is that the horn will be painful and it will be large in size, and there will be induration in the base, and this based upon the site also, if it is located over the nose, ears, backs of the hands, it is more possibility is that this cutaneous horn is having squamous cell carcinoma at the base. And also there are some other features, but please remember, most probably they will ask you these first four of the criteria and not beyond that. Okay, yes, Valarmati is asking treatment. So treatment will be it should be removed in toto with the help of excisional biopsy and sent to histopathological examination, and we should see what is the causative agent or causative what is the underlying cause. That is, either it can be benign like seborrheic keratosis or viral warts, or it can be premalignant actinic keratosis, or it can be even underlying malignancy squamous cell carcinoma. Okay, so now please tell me if this question was given or not in the exam, and were the option same or anything different was there, and this fourth option I didn't got. Yes, yes, very good. Those who have attended Dr. Ramya ma'am's class, I think all of you are answering it right. Very good. So it is a case of condylom acuminatum. My name is my so tuberculous lymph ulcer, pardon. Yes, okay, the tuberculous lymph ulcer, it is not, that is not there here. Yes, very good. Okay, so I can see most of you are answering right now, right? I hope all, so I hope all of you have answered the same way in the exam also. So it is acuminata. Please remember, as ma'am told, yes, condyloma lata, you should remember it as flata. So I remembered it like this. So I will show you first where condyloma lata is seen and how it will be appearing. So it will appear, it will seen in secondary syphilis. It is secondary syphilis, characteristic of secondary syphilis, and it is highly contagious lesion where clinically broad flat papules or plaques, flocks will be seen. So this will be the appearance of the condyloma lata. So how I remembered is, I just keep F and I will remember it as flata. Whereas this image, you can see the lesions are somewhat pointed and they are having some cauliflower like growth, if you want me to say the word specifically. And even you can see this question was asked by me also before. This was a neat question, in fact, and this I have asked on 8th of July, 8th July I have asked. So this was a neat question. So I think maybe this much question may have been given, but I have just given that image is classical of. Okay, so it is human papilloma virus which is the causative agent for the anogenital warts, and in anogenital warts they are named as condyloma acuminata. Why? Because acumen is a point, so clinical acumen they will say. So acumen is the sharpness or the pointedness. Okay, so that is the reason why this particular appearance is given the term acuminata. Here there will be fleshy pink pointed growths, or you can say also cauliflower like growths can also be seen. Okay, these can be also images which can be asked. This is an image of Condyloma acuminata, that is what present over the male genitals. Okay, and this was a AIIMS question which was asked in the June session. So yeah, the only point which I want to tell you is there are no oral medications which can be given for anogenital warts. This is also important because in the AIIMS this question came, where the answer was of course genital warts. The diagnosis is genital warts. The question was asking to give prophylactic antivirals, give antivirals. So all these options were there. This was exact question. So all these options are wrong. The only correct answer is don't involve in sexual intercourse when active lesions are present. So this is the right answer. So Rameshri ma'am already told. So yes, it is podophyllin and also imiquimod which can be given topically if the patient is non-pregnant. But if at all pregnancy is confirmed, then we have to avoid podophyllin and imiquimod because they are teratogenic, and we will use cryotherapy and trichloristic acid otherwise. Sir, okay, forgot which one. So exactly which one. Okay, they have asked for vulvar area image. Okay, Shilpa Chandrasekhar is telling vulvar area. Okay, so point noted. Okay, yes. Okay, this question was the question same, and were the options same? Was anything different? So please do let me know. Was the term ulcerative colitis mentioned? And anterior leg ulcer, and was the image same like this? So please tell me. Yes, tubarias. Okay, I can understand that. I can understand. I can relate it very well. So definitely, they should have at least given a hint that it can be possibly mostly a type of clinical based scenarios. Yes, okay. So okay, I think all these were given, so thank you for confirmation. Okay, erythema nodosum was there. Okay, so Disha is telling whether it is ulcerative colitis or erythema nodosum which was given. Okay, answer is pyoderma gangrenosum. Very good friends. So please tell me if ulcerative colitis was given in the question body or erythema nodosum was mentioned. So please do let me know. There was one option close to pyoderma. No, don't remember. Okay, was also. Achha, erythema nodosum was in the options. Okay, thank you Aniket for telling this. Please remember, erythema nodosum will never ulcerate and the lesions are going to be present over the anterior leg, no doubt. But erythema nodosum is not going to ulcerate. So erythema nodosum and erythema induratum of Buzzin. It is erythema induratum of Buzzin is a type of it's a type of tuber. It's a type. 1 second, please. So erythema induratum of Buzzin is going to cough and it is going to have the ulcers. So if at all erythema nodosum is there, then it is not going to be a problem. Pyoderma vegetans. So okay, pyoderma vegetans is given in the options. So that is not related to this particular condition. Okay. So okay. Thank you for telling the option pyoderma vegetans. Okay. Thank you, friends. And always remember, whenever you read pyoderma gangrenosum, you also read sweet syndrome hand in hand, both of them put together. So in sweet syndrome, it is an acute febrile neutrophilic dermatosis. That is, there will be infiltration of the neutrophils in the histopath in the skin, and there will be nodules and fever and the associations of the sweet syndrome. So here you can see these are the nodules, erythematous nodules, and along with that there will be a prodrome and also a fever history can be there. And there are associations like adenocarcinoma, that is gastric adenocarcinoma, and also AML. Whereas in pyoderma gangrenosum, there will be ulcers, and the characteristics of these ulcers is undermining type of ulcers. undermined edge will be there for the ulcers, and there are associations. The most important one is ulcerative colitis, and there are other ones like Crohn's disease, rheumatoid arthritis, systemic lupus erythematosus, and malignancies like CML and non-Hodgkin's lymphoma. Okay, Marina is asking, diabetic patient has pyoderma gangrenosum. So I want to tell you that pyoderma gangrenosum is a misnomer. In fact, why? Because this is not infectious cause. This is not infectious cause, neither it is an infection. So pyoderma is a misnomer, and also there is gangrene, neither pyoderma nor gangrene as well. So this is a double misnomer. The treatment which we give for sweet syndrome as well as the pyoderma gangrenosum is corticosteroids. So please remember, these are not infectious. These are due to neutrophilic infiltration. These are neutrophilic dermatoses. Okay. So I hope it is clear. Okay. Ulcerative colitis was in the option with the picture based question is what Najib is telling. Okay. So is that a different question? So friends, so Najib is telling that ulcerative colitis was an option with a picture based question. So please tell me whether it was same question or it was altogether a different question. So please tell me friends, if it is same question or it was altogether a different question. So ulcerative colitis, same question. Okay, thank you for confirmation. Okay, so yes, thank you. So this is a one tool which helps us to diagnose this particular pyoderma gangrenosum. It is Paracelsus tool. Maybe in future they can ask you, so that's the reason why I'm just mentioning about this. It will help us to diagnose pyoderma gangrenosum if we add all these points. Points are given basically. So if there is rapid progression, we'll give 3 points, and if there is a violaceous hue at the margin, we are going to give 3 points. And as you can see in this particular picture, there is slight violaceous hue which can be seen at the margins of this ulcer. Okay, so there can be possibility that in future they might not even give this clue of ulcerative colitis in the question, and they can just give you the image and they can ask you. Yes, Patel Swati, there is very very high chance that these questions can be repeated in the NEET, because obviously these are the part and parcel of the question bank of National Board of Examinations, which is the same body which is going to make the questions for NEET. So there is high possibility that these will be repeated again. Okay. Yes, and this is also there, and the other points are there. But please remember, the only thing which I want to tell you is, if at all there is more than 10 points, then the possibility of the pyoderma gangrenosum is very highly likely. Okay. That is all which you need to know. Paracelsus is the tool used for pyoderma gangrenosum diagnosis. Okay, so please tell whether this question was asked, and were the options same, and was the image same, and was the question body same. So Fernandez, extended part of the question was and presented with more similar lesions elsewhere. Okay. Okay, point noted. So was the question same? Was something additionally given in the question? Were the options same? This image was not there. Okay, Aniket is telling him this image was not there. Okay, even I want to tell you one thing, that even if this image is not given, with all the question clues given in the question, you can easily answer. Why? Because there is a history of severe sunburn, and if there is a mention of course photosensitivity was given, and also freckling was mentioned, and dry skin was mentioned, and changes of skin pigmentation. So all these are pointing out for xeroderma pigmentosum only. So were the option same? Was molluscum contagiosum given in the question? So this, please, I want to know whether molluscum contagiosum was given in the option or not. Yes or no? Okay, photosensitivity point, sun-exposed point present. Okay, Fernandez telling molluscum contagiosum is there. Okay. So, this is outright wrong because this will present as pearly white umbilicated papules, and also melanocytic nevus is going to present, it can be congenital or acquired. Melanocytic nevus will be a localized hyperpigmentation, and in that photosensitivity and freckling and dry skin are not going to be mentioned. And in the Bloom syndrome, they can mention about the poikilodermata skin changes. So few points about Bloom syndrome I want to tell you, because it, but please tell me, Bloom syndrome was given in the options? Was Bloom syndrome is given in one of the options? So just yes, okay, thank you, Fernandez. So if it is Bloom syndrome, there will be mention of short stature, skin rash, and photosensitivity will be there as it is, and there will be poikiloderma. Poikiloderma includes atrophy, atrophic changes of the skin, telangiectasias, that is permanently dilated, enlarged blood vessels, and there will be pigmented changes, hypo and hyperpigmentation changes. So since none of these are given in the question, only photosensitivity is there, then it is going to be xeroderma pigmentosum. And before that, I want to just tell you that freckling, that is ephelids. So I want to show you the image. So this this is the one Hollywood actor. She is having tiny hyperpigmented macules over the face. So these are called freckles, and the characteristic of these freckles is that they will be present on the sun exposed sites, and they are going to reduce in the winter. That is, in the summer, the intensity of the pigmentation is going to increase. And about xeroderma pigmentosum, few points. Xeroderma pigmentosum, the name itself is derived from xeroderma, which means dry skin. Okay, xeroderma, xerosis, wherever is there, it means xeroderma, wherever it is there, it means that they want to mention about the dryness. Okay, and photo pigmentosum, there will be photosensitivity and photophobia both, and also this condition is autosomal recessive, and there is nucleotide excision repair, and there is going to be a defect in the endonucleus. There is increased risk of cancers, that is all the types of cancers can be increased, that is squamous cell carcinoma, basal cell carcinoma, actinic keratosis, and malignant melanomas. So unlike the cutaneous horn, where only the possibility of squamous cell carcinoma is there, in xeroderma pigmentosum, the patient can develop all the types of malignancies. Yes, Jinesh, axillary freckling is seen in neurofibromatosis. You are very much correct, and it is called as Crowley's sign. Okay, it is called as Crowley's sign. Very good. So now please tell me if this particular question was given in the exam. So whether the question was same, and so please try to answer this particular question in the chat section, friends. Okay, Hari Krishnan, thank you for the input. Both hand and feet image was given. Okay, thank you so much. Point is noted. Both hand and feet, thank you. Somewhat same. Okay, same picture of Anand Solveri. So I can see most of you have answered it right. So very good, friends. Yes, so from the question, it is very clear that they have mentioned mouth and hands and feet are involved. So it is hand, foot, mouth disease. So the causative organism, yes, Jinesh, you are right. So it is going to have these small vesicles. They can even pustules with surrounding erythema. So this vesicle surrounded by a base of erythema is characteristic of hand, foot, mouth disease, and it is basically an enteroviral infection. Coxsackie A16 and enterovirus 71. These are the strains which are responsible. But in the question, Coxsackie A16 has been mentioned. So there will be an oral enanthem, that is ulceration will be there, and exanthem in the form of papular vesicles will be there. Both the palm soles and even buttocks can also be involved. And there is one more condition which is caused due to enteroviral infections. It is herpangina. And the most important characteristic, this can be a potential future MCQ for NEET and also FMG, December FMG. So that is the reason why I have put it here. This particular herpangina is caused by Coxsackie A1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 subtypes and enterovirus 71, just like hand, foot, mouth disease. There is going to be oral enanthem, but please remember, no cutaneous features are going to be seen in herpangina. This point is very important. That is the reason why I have put it in this discussion here. Herpangina is not going to have any cutaneous features. Okay. Okay. HHV6 is mentioned in the question. Is what few students are telling. So please tell me if HHV6 was given in the options. So everyone does agree that HHV6 is given. Okay, so HHV6 was also given, but please remember HHV6, there is not going to be this particular type of papular vesicles or the hand's feet, and there will not be any sores in the mouth. It is going to only present with lesions or the skin, but not involvement of mouth, or there will not be any development of enanthem. That is how this can be differentiated. And please tell me if at all human papilloma virus was also mentioned. Okay, few students are telling HHV6 is not given in this particular question. So even if HHV6 is given, but even if it is given, so it is very classical for hand, foot, mouth disease, and the causative agent is Coxsackie A16. Okay, so it's not good, should not be a possible confusion whatsoever. Okay. So now please tell me whether this question was given and was the image the same and the options were the same, or anything was given additionally. Okay, Aniket is telling one image of buccal mucosa, one image of hand, foot was given. Okay, then it is actually very straightforward question of hand, foot, mouth disease. Okay. Okay, Aniket is telling this question was there, and was the image given the same image, or was the question body asking about in which disease we can see pleomorphic type of lesions, or was the question same like this with giving lesions which change from one stage to another? Okay, age was mentioned. So, okay, point is noted. So, age was mentioned as 10 years. Okay, quite similar question. Okay, thank you for confirmation. And what have you marked, friends? So please tell me, what did you mark for this question? They did mention pleoma. Okay, thank you so much, Hari Krishnan, for confirmation. So they did mention it is a pleomorphic rash, then it is even more easy. Okay, monster says measles. Okay, so does everyone agree with the answer given by monster? So please remember, those who have answered it as measles. I didn't thought that students will answer it as measles. So please remember, if at all the question mentioned pleomorphic as a word, it cannot be measles. Why? Because measles will have incubation period of 10 days, and it will present with maculopapular rash, which starts of the frontal area of the face. That is cephalic end, and it will progress to caudal end. That is, cephalocaudal progression will be there. This should be mentioned in the question body. Otherwise, it cannot be a measles. So measles is not the right answer here, friends. So the answer, correct answer here is chickenpox. If at all pleomorphic is given, I think so many students do agree that pleomorphic was given. So what is this pleomorphic lesion? I will just show you a picture. So this is a flow chart which I have made. So if at all the initial lesion is a papule, and it is progressing stage wise to papule vesicles, pustules, and finally crust. So this progression of the lesion, of the same lesion. So the initial lesion of papule will convert into vesicle, and again it will become pustule and finally crust. So this progression of a single lesion into different types of lesions as the disease progresses is called pleomorphic, and it is very characteristic of chickenpox or varicella. Okay, it is very characteristic of varicella or chickenpox, and even they can mention that dewdrop on rose petal kind of appearance is there in which disease. This can also be a potential MCQ. Okay, so these are all additional points. So distribution will be centripetal. That is, it is mainly concentrated over the trunk and maximum to the proximal limbs. And in the question, even a smallpox is mentioned, but smallpox is eradicated already. A few points about the smallpox are that the lesions in this are going to be monomorphic. Okay, at any given point of time, all the lesions are going to be similar. Same type of lesions will be seen. Okay, now please tell me if this question was asked and if the options were the same and this image, all these were given. If at all, then please do message in the chat section. And please remember, this is a chronically repeated question in FMG also. So this was like asked some 3 to 4 times. Okay, Arya Surendran says measles question coming one cough, fever, respiratory distress. Okay, so Arya says that measles was a different question. Okay, so others, if at all you agree, please do let me know. So image was different. Okay, image was different. Okay, Samir is telling similar picture. Okay, so somewhat similar type of picture was given is what Samir is telling. So what have you answered, friends? Yes, I hope this is answered right, because this is repeated so many times. So yes, the answer is zinc. They give hand image with redness and swelling for this question. Okay, they gave hand image. Was hand image given? Okay, thank you, Disha Sudan. So thank you for the input. Somewhat same. Okay. Picture. So what Aniket told was hand image given for this question. Yes, Aniket, right. Zinc. So it is acrodermatitis enteropathica. So if at all image of limbs is given, then also it is a very good question with a very good clue. Why? Because the disease acrodermatitis enteropathica is given the name. Why? Because there will be periorificial and also acral. So what is the meaning of acral is, it is the extremities. Acra are the extremities. No, hand was not there. Okay, so even if it is there also, we can that means we can relate and we can explain it because it is acrodermatitis enteropathica and acra are will be can be involved. It is basically autosomal recessive disease, acrodermatitis enteropathica, where there will be difficulty or defect in absorption of the zinc. And I have I have discussed this in my class along with pellagra. Why? Because the two features, dermatitis and diarrhea, are same for these two conditions. The only difference is that in pellagra, it is going to be a dementia, and also if at all it is not identified and treated promptly. Whereas in the case of acrodermatitis enteropathica, there will be alopecia along with dermatitis and diarrhea. Okay. And pellagra, it is a very famous question. It is due to B3 or niacin deficiency and Castle's necklace. This is a Castle's necklace which can be seen in the case of pellagra. So this can be a potential MCQ in the future sessions. So I just want to show, this is from a journal. So this is a picture which can be given. So something related to this, with where the infant is having involvement, eczematous changes over the scalp, over the periorificial area, perioral and also periocular areas, and also here perianal and perineal area, all are involved. Okay. And if in case hand image was given, then also we can explain it in acrodermatitis enteropathica very much. Okay. And what is the treatment which can be given for these children is we can give zinc at the dosage of up to 3 milligrams per kilo. The dosages and treatment most probably will not be asked, but if in case they ask you, it can be like, yes, it can be like 3 mg per kilogram per day can be given in the initial stages, and later on we can reduce the dosage according to the response which is seen in the infant. Yes, Fernandez, just these two topics are extremely important, acrodermatitis enteropathica and pellagra. Yes, even I have discussed all these in my FMG MCQ marathon sessions on Unacademy. You can see these sessions. So these were the questions which I got. So if you feel any more questions were asked, so please do let me know in the comment section now. So if at all any questions are given additionally in the exam, then I will try to make a small video, YouTube video, or I will try to discuss them in the in different platforms. So Jinesh, the alopecia here, it is going to be non-scarring type of alopecia only. Okay. So please just take 1 or 2 minutes. I will just see the comment section 1 or 2 minutes, and please do let me know if any additional question came. So few students told me that a tubercular ulcer came, that is over the neck, and they were telling that it was tubercular ulcer. So and apart from that, any more questions were asked which is related to dermatology. Okay, thank you Veena, thank you Jinesh. So please do comment in the chat section whether any more questions were asked. So thank you so much friends. I hope so. Do not worry about the difficulty of the questions, and it was not just difficult for you alone. There were many students who felt that the session, this particular FMG exam was very difficult. Measles, okay, Fernandez noted. So I think now the next session is going to begin. So I do not want to disturb you guys. Yes, sure, I will do it, Kanch. So you can get this soft copy. Yes. Okay, so thank you so much. Measles and the tubercular ulcer were there. So please do join the next session where medicine is going to be discussed. So I thank you so much for all your patient listening and all your active participation. So thank you so much for all your inputs, friends. So this means a lot, this helps me a lot. Okay, thank you so much. And that's it for this session, friends. So do not, if at all you feel bad about this session, please do not feel bad. The only thing which you can do is do reflect on this paper and just try to see in which areas you made mistakes and which areas you can improve as. And if at all, I hope all of you clear with this particular session itself. But please do continue with your preparation and keep your next target as December session FMG. But I from my heart, I wish that all of you do finish this FMG phase with this exam itself, and all of you will join internship after this. So that's it, friends. Thank you so much. We'll end this session now. Thank you so much for all your patience.